يا يحيى خذ الكتاب بقوة وآتيناه الحكم صبيا
إذ قال الله يا عيسى إني متوفيك ورافعك إلي
محمد رسول الله.
السلام عليكم ورحمة الله. إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا، من يهديه الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله. Welcome to another episode of Quran in Depth, and we are in Surah Al-A'raf, this blessed surah that talks about many different things and great benefits to be learned from this great surah about the struggle between the truth and falsehood, for the iman to be steadfast, to be strong in the hearts of the believers. It's a surah that was revealed to the Prophet ﷺ in Mecca. And as we know that the Mecca time, when the Prophet ﷺ was there for 13 years, the Prophet ﷺ faced all kinds of trials and difficulties in inviting people to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to worship none but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone. He was opposed by the ways of the forefathers, by the arrogance of the people in charge and people of authority. And he was patient, alayhi salatu wasalam, having the concern towards them. And it would hurt the Prophet, alayhi salatu wasalam, that they are turning away from the truth. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed these surahs to the Prophet, alayhi salatu wasalam, to give him the steadfastness, to show the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasalam and the ummah of the Prophet, alayhi salatu wasalam, since there is no more messengers to come, to show them the ways of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on the face of earth, and how that this is a matter that is always repeated, and for the believers not to be deceived by the superiority sometimes of the people of falsehood, because the shayateen, the devils, are deceiving most of the human beings except for those who hold fast to the wahi, to the revelation from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We're still in the story of Adam alayhi salam, the beginning of the creation of the human beings, and the story of Adam alayhi salam with Iblis, with Shaitan. And it shows that this everlasting enmity that is going to continue till the day of judgment, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala granted Shaitan by the will of Allah that he would not die till the day of judgment. And why? And what is the job of the devil, Shaitan? Is to whisper to the people, to lead them astray, to make them die in the state of disbelief or in the state of sin, whatever he can get from the people, because he doesn't leave anybody alone whatsoever. Every single human being, he would sit by the straight path for them to deviate them from it, as we heard in the previous verses. Inshallah ta'ala, in this episode, we'll try to go through verses number 22 from Surah Al-A'raf till 27. From 22 to 27, and we're continuing the story. So this, what we're going to say now, it's built on what has been mentioned before in the previous episode. And the last thing we talked about, that when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said to Adam alayhi salam for him and his wife to dwell in Jannah, and he permitted them to eat from all things there except one specific tree. And the shaitan, he whispered to them. Why? To take them out. And this is something that he took upon himself, and that the ways of shaitan is to take the people to be in that state of showing their awrah, their private parts, their what ought to be covered, and it's mentioned in the verse. So the shaitan whispered to them. And then in verse number 22, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says what happened as a result of this whispering of the shaitan to Adam alayhi salam and his wife. Verse number 22, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in it, فَدَلَّهُمَا بِغُرُورٍ فَلَمَّا ذَاقَ الشَّجَرَةَ بَدَتْ لَهُمَا سَوْآتُهُمَا وَطَفِقَا يَخْصِفَانِ عَلَيْهِمَا مِنْ وَرَقِ الْجَنَّةِ وَنَادَاهُمَا رَبُّهُمَا أَلَمْ أَنْهَكُمَا عَنْ تِلْكُمَا الشَّجَرَةِ وَأَقُلْ لَكُمَا إِنَّ الشَّيْطَانَ لَكُمَا عَدُوٌّ مُبِينٌ. Which means, so he made them fall through deception, and when they tasted of the tree, their private parts became apparent to them, and they began to fasten together over themselves from the leaves of paradise. And their Lord called to them, did I not forbid you from that tree and tell you that shaitan, Satan, is to you a clear enemy? فَدَلَّهُمَا بِغُرُورٍ. It means he made them fall. And this is something when it comes down. He took them, he made them fall step after another. He whispered to them. He adorned the evil to them. As it's mentioned before, that he said to Adam and his wife, that the only reason why you're forbidden from this tree is that so that you don't become an angel or that you would live forever. So he deceived them and he made them fall by disobeying the orders of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. فَلَمَّ ذَاقَ الشَّجَرَةِ. When they tasted the tree, immediately after they tasted it and they disobeyed Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with regards to this tree, بَدَتْ لَهُمَا سَوْآتُهُمَا. سَوْآتُهُمَا, this is dual for both Adam and his wife, that their private parts become apparent to one another. It was said it was hidden from one another. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created Adam alayhi salam. And this is in the fitrah, in the nature of the human being, that they cover the awrah, they cover their private parts. And we know there is ahkam, rulings with regards to this, whether it's inside salah or outside of the salah. And Muslims are known by this, known by the shyness that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made it in the hearts of the human beings. And this is from one prophet to the other. This is not something unique to the deen of Islam or to the message of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. Throughout the entire journey of prophethood, the prophets would order the people to have the shyness and to cover themselves from the time of Adam alayhi salam. So when they disobeyed Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and the shaitan knew this, and as it's mentioned previously in the verses, and his goal was for them to expose themselves, for them to be exposed. This is one of the works of shaitan on the face of earth, is to make people not covered, to make people not observe the shyness and the modesty of being covered and being away from following their desires and lusts and so on. The relationship between men and women, that is to be guarded by the orders of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So as a result of them tasting the tree, بَدَتْ لَهُمَا سَوْآتُهُمَا, their awrah, and it's called سَوْآ. And سَوْآ in the Arabic language, it doesn't sound good, because it's something that a person would have himself, he would be hurt if it get exposed. The people of decency, if their private parts is exposed, they would find pain inside. This is something that is shameful for them. And it's always shameful for those who have honor and dignity and shyness and iman and faith, of course. And the opposite of that, it means that the person had lost these great qualities that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bestowed upon the human beings. So the goal of the shaitan was this, one of the goals in which their private parts became apparent. وَطَفِقَا يَخْصِفَانِ عَلَيْهِمَا مِنْ وَرَقِ الْجَنَّةِ. وَطَفِقَا يَخْصِفَانِ, that means they kept on stretching or pulling and trying to fasten together over themselves from the leaves of Al-Jannah. وَطَفِقَا يَخْصِفَانِ عَلَيْهِمَا, they kept on pulling and bringing the leaves from Jannah, where they were in, to cover themselves as a result of the awrah being exposed. Of course, in the books of the tafsir, there are kinds of things mentioned, like it was covered with light and the light became in their hands and not in their private parts as a result of eating from the tree. They try to cover themselves. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows best. These are matters of Israeliyat, from the words of the people of Bani Israel. So Adam alayhi salam and his wife, they try to cover themselves after they've been exposed as a result of that sin being committed. And then it says, وَنَادَاهُمَا رَبُّهُمَا, and their Lord, رَبُّهُمَا, for both, meaning Adam and his wife. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, their Lord, called them, أَلَمْ أَنْهَكُمَا, didn't I forbid you? عَنْ تِلْكُمَا الشَّجَرَةِ, I forbade you from that specific tree, from that tree, a specific one. وَأَقُلْ لَكُمَا إِنَّ الشَّيْطَانَ لَكُمَا عَدُوٌ مُبِينٌ, and I told you that shaitan is to you a clear enemy. That means the warning came clear from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is reprimanding them, is reminding them. Why would you eat from that tree that you have been forbidden from eating? And the matter was made clear. The one that is the creator of all things, he's the one that forbid. And for the human beings, they have a choice, yes. And they have been warned also from the whispers of shaitan that he will be your enemy and he will try to take you away from all kinds of goodness. So do not obey him. But they end up falling into the whispers of shaitan and they ate from the tree disobeying Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So when they've heard this and they regretted the sin that they committed, as it's mentioned in the next verse, verse number 23, قَالَ رَبَّنَا ظَلَمْنَا أَنفُسَنَا وَإِن لَمْ تَغْفِرْ لَنَا وَتَرْحَمْنَا لَنَكُونَنَّ مِنَ الْخَاسِرِينَ, which means, they said, our Lord, we have wronged ourselves, and if you do not forgive us and have mercy upon us, we will surely be among the losers. قَالَ again, it's not قَالَ meaning one, it's both. It's in the dual tense. Both Adam and his wife, قَالَ, both of them, they said, رَبَّنَا, our Lord, and the significance of رَبَّنَا, our Lord, the one that created us, the one that provides for us, the one that forgives. ظَلَمْنَا أَنفُسَنَا, ظَلَمْنَا أَنفُسَنَا, we wronged ourselves, we committed injustice against our own self. And that's what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told them, as we heard in the previous verses, that if you eat from the tree, as He said to them, وَلَا تَقَرَبَ هَذِهِ الشَّجَرَةِ فَتَكُونَ مِنَ الظَّالِمِينَ, do not approach this tree, otherwise you'll be among the ظالمين, the wrongdoers. So they said, رَبَّنَا, our Lord, ظَلَمْنَا أَنفُسَنَا, we wronged ourselves. وَإِن لَمْ تَغْفِرْ لَنَا وَتَرْحَمْنَا, and if you do not forgive us, nor you have mercy upon us, لَنَكُونَنَّ مِنَ الْخَاسِرِينَ, definitely, no doubt, we'll be among the losers. This is something that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala inspired Adam when He taught him the names of things. He was inspired to ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for forgiveness in the most perfect way. This is the way to ask forgiveness from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and as we know that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accepted the repentance of Adam and his wife. So these words and the meanings of it is very important for us to learn. And the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam taught us, Sayyidul Istighfar, the best way to seek forgiveness from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has the same style of wordings. اللهم أنت ربي لا إله إلا أنت خلقتني وأنا عبدك وأنا على عهدك ووعدك ما استطعت أعوذ بك من شر ما صنعت أبوء لك بنعمتك علي وأبوء بذنبي. At the end of the dhikr, the person would say, I acknowledge and I confess about my sin. And then he would ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for forgiveness. This is the humbleness. This is the grief and the sadness and the regret that should be present in the heart, which makes the tawbah, the repentance, sincere and pure for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So they acknowledge that they committed sins. And you can compare this to what the shaitan did. When the shaitan was ordered to make sujood to Adam alayhi salam, he refused and he was arrogant. That's why he was kicked out of the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forever. Adam alayhi salam and his wife, they realized and they acknowledged and they confessed that they wronged themselves. And this is the humbleness that a person should have in their hearts. When it comes to sins, people are either imitating the ways of shaitan or following the ways of Adam alayhi salam. We all fall into sins, but there are major difference between someone arrogantly approve the sinful life for himself or the sins that he commits, and he would belittle the repentance, for example, and he would say, why would I repent? What's wrong with this and what's wrong with that? Opposing the orders of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and it's all arrogant and it's a very dangerous route for a person to take. And someone else, he would say that he wronged himself, that he committed sins, that he is regretting what he did, and that's why it's one of the conditions of repentance, to regret the sin. قَالَ رَبَّنَا ظَلَمْنَا أَنفُسَنَا. If we look into the Quran, you would find the same words, whether it's in different wordings, but the same meanings, whenever someone would ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for forgiveness, as the prophets of Allah did, like Musa alayhi salam and others. And the forgiveness is from Allah, the mercy is from Allah. Forgiveness is for the outcome and the punishment of the sin to be concealed and not to happen, and the rahmah, the mercy of Allah, for the person to enter the Jannah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and to have the mercy of Allah bestowed upon the person. Otherwise, they are among the losers. We'll continue inshallah ta'ala with more of these verses after the break, so stay with us inshallah.
محمد رسول الله.
I spend my life running away from you. Now I have nowhere to turn except to you.
Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He created man, and man has outer features as well as inner features. One of the most important of his inner features is his heart. So what is the heart? What is meant by this heart that is in our bodies? And what is the health of the heart? And what is the disease of the heart? There are many diseases of the heart, and there are many actions of the heart, things that make it healthy. So what are these diseases? What are these actions? Come and join us on Huda TV in this program of ours, Heart Therapy.
So drink my heart, please, wash the filth away. Don't leave me drowning here, alone and astray. Don't leave me drowning here, alone and astray.
محمد رسول الله
الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله. Welcome back, and with verses number 22 to 27 from Surat Al-A'raf, and the story of the beginning of the creation of Adam and the struggle between Adam عليه السلام and Shaitan, and the sin that Adam عليه السلام and his wife committed, and they acknowledged it and they confessed to it. And they asked Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to forgive them and to have mercy upon them. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the most forgiver. He forgave Adam alayhi salam. And therefore no sin, no individuals, no human being is born sinful. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the most just. The sin that Adam alayhi salam committed, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgave him, accepted the repentance of Adam alayhi salam, and the matter is over. Yes, the consequence of it is something that the human beings, the sons of Adam, would see till the day of judgment, and that is to be on the face of earth. But for those to enter the Jannah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala are the believers, and the disbelievers will enter the hellfire. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned this in the Quran, and that Adam alayhi salam and his wife, they said, O our Lord, رَبَّنَا ظَلَمْنَا أَنفُسَنَا, we wronged ourselves. وَإِن لَمْ تَغْفِرْ لَنَا وَتَرْحَمْنَا, if you do not forgive us, and if you don't have mercy upon us, لَنَكُنَنَّ مِنَ الْخَاسِرِينَ, we will be among the losers. And this is something that we need to focus upon. This is the real loss in this life and in the hereafter. The real loss is when the person is not forgiven. Because as a default in ourselves as human beings, we are sinners. If Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala treat us with His justice, all of us will be in the hellfire. We are in need of the forgiveness from Allah. It's the most important need after being guided, after being upon the deen of Allah, is to be forgiven, is to be among the repentant slaves to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala after fulfilling the orders of Allah. Otherwise, a person is a loser according to how much sin that a person incurred upon himself. So the goal of our life is to be among those who are forgiven. So we have to take the means of it by exalting the orders of Allah, having the proper belief. As we know that one sin that is never forgiven, if a person dies with it, which is a shirk, إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يَغْفِرُ أَيُشْرَكَ بِهِ وَيَغْفِرُ مَا دُونَ ذَلِكَ لِمَنْ يَشَاءُ, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not forgive that someone would associate partners with him, and he forgives everything other than that. So a shirk, if a person dies upon it, it's the unforgivable sin. Other than that, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala can forgive the person. But while a person is alive, this is the life or the job of a lifetime, is to constantly repent to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and to seek forgiveness from Allah and to seek the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The Jannah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the mercy of Allah. People will enter it by the bounty and the favor of Allah. They do not deserve it, but it's by the mercy of Allah. Forgiveness is from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If whether they desire to be punished, or they deserve to be punished. Why? Because they committed the sin. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the most just. But the forgiveness is something higher. Something that is, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He's the most merciful. He bestowed this upon the people. Otherwise, the person is among the losers. But then what happened is that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgave Adam alayhi salam and his wife, but He made something for them, and that is for them to descend on the face of earth. As it's mentioned in the next verse, verse number 24, قَالَ اهْبِطُوا بَعْضُكُمْ لِبَعْضٍ عَدُوٌّ وَلَكُمْ فِي الْأَرْضِ مُسْتَقَرٌّ وَمَتَاعٌ إِلَى حِينٍ, which means Allah said, descend, being to one another enemies, and for you on the earth is a place of settlement and enjoyment for a time. قَالَ, meaning Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said to them, when they show their regret and they asked Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for forgiveness, He said to them, اهبطوا, descend, go down, meaning on the face of earth. And اهبطوا is in the plural tense, and that refers to Adam and his wife and Shaytan Iblis. بَعْضُكُمْ لِبَعْضٍ عَدُوٍ, you will be enemies to one another. And that is the Shaytan versus the human beings. And of course the human beings to one another. And this is all by the work of Shaytan. Shaytan is the enemy. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned in the Quran, إِنَّ الشَّيْطَانَ لَكُمْ عَدُوٍ فَاتَّخِذُوا عَدُوًا. Shaytan is your enemy, so take him as your enemy. He is showing his enmity. He's working based on this enmity by deceiving people, by making them among the people of the hellfire because of their own actions, by adorning the evil to them. And when people are not aware of the enmity of Shaytan, after they know that from the revelation from Allah, then they should not blame anyone but their own selves when they are deceived. That's why really it's very is as clear as it's mentioned like this. If people do not follow the wahi, the revelation from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, they are deceived by the Shaytan, and they would say words like, I think, or I believe, or I see that this is what is right, or this is wrong, things of that nature. And people think that it's their intellect and their reason and their logic that they use. And most of it is all adorning the Shaytan, adorning the evil to them. If they oppose the wahi from Allah, anything that is opposite to what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed to the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, is all adorned by the ways of the Shayateen. Something that does not make sense, something that is against the human nature, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would only order the people to do what is good and forbade them from doing what is evil. So therefore, to know this as a fact, this is something that makes it easy for the person to be steadfast upon the deen of Allah. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ordered them, all of them, to descend, and they become enemies to one another, and we have to take the Shaytan as enemy and to know how to protect ourselves from the ways of the Shaytan. وَلَكُمْ فِي الْأَرْضِ مُسْتَقَرٌ وَمَتَاعٌ إِلَى حِينٍ. That means you will have on the face of earth, al-ard is this earth, mustaqar, a place of settlement. You'll settle there. وَمَتَاعٌ إِلَى حِينٍ, and some enjoyment, some life, some time, إِلَى حِينٍ, to a specific time. A specific time for each individual. Every person, when the moment of death comes, nobody can push that away. Every person has a limited time, specific numbers of breath that a person would take on the face of earth, and we see that clearly. And people do not all die on a specific date, meaning that one generation do not live and then they are all dead in one day and then the next generation comes, but rather every day how many people they return to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and how many people they are born. And that means each person has their specific appointed time for their soul to be taken away from their bodies and for them to return to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So then the other meaning, of course, which is clear, that the human race will be upon the earth for a specific time, till the day of judgment. Till the day of judgment, then all will die and they all shall return to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said that to Adam alayhi salam, that they would have a place of settling on the face of earth. This is the place of livelihood. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will provide for them and the offsprings of Adam alayhi salam, but to entrust them to understand the purpose of their life, and that is to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone. And this is ila heen, to a specific time where the moment of death comes and everybody returns to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Then more with regards to the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on earth that He decreed and He created. He said subhanahu wa ta'ala in the next verse, قَالَ فِيهَا تَحْيَوْنَ وَفِيهَا تَمُوتُونَ وَمِنْهَا تُخْرَجُونَ, which means He said, therein you will live and therein you will die, and from it you will be brought forth, meaning in the earth. قَالَ فِيهَا تَحْيَوْنَ, therein, in the earth, you will live. تَحْيَوْنَ, you would live on the face of earth, as we see, we're alive on the face of earth, but for a appointed time. وَفِيهَا تَمُوتُونَ, and you will die also therein. You won't die somewhere else, you will die on the earth. And وَمِنْهَا تُخْرَجُونَ, and from it you will be تُخْرَجُونَ, you will be brought forth, meaning in the day of resurrection, in the day of Al-Qiyamah, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, things will be changed and people will be resurrected from the places where they died, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala promised. قَالَ فِيهَا تَحْيَوْنَ وَفِيهَا تَمُوتُونَ وَمِنْهَا تُخْرَجُونَ, and the one that gave you life on the face of earth, and the one that would make you die on the face of earth, He's the one, subhanahu wa ta'ala, that is able to resurrect you again. And this is one of the pillars of al-Iman, is to believe in the resurrection in the day of al-Qiyamah. Then after that, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala calls the sons of Adam. And this is for each and every one of us to learn from the story of Adam alayhi salam. Adam alayhi salam is the father of all of the human beings. And he did what is part of the nature of the human beings. They can easily be deceived by the ways of shaitan. Adam alayhi salam repented to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accepted his repentance. The sons of Adam, they go through the same trial. And if they do not repent to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that means they subject themselves to the punishment of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the next ayah, يَا بَنِي آدَمَ قَدْ أَنزَلْنَا عَلَيْكُمْ لِبَاسًا يُوَارِي سَوْآتِكُمْ وَرِيشًا وَلِبَاسُ التَّقْوَى ذَلِكَ خَيْرٌ ذَلِكَ مِنْ آيَاتِ اللَّهِ لَعَلَّهُمْ يَذَّكَّرُونَ. Which means, O children of Adam, we have bestowed upon you clothing to conceal your private parts and as adornment. But the clothing of righteousness, that is best. That is from the signs of Allah that perhaps they will remember. Ya Bani Adam, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is calling not just Adam alayhi salam, but calling the children of Adam, which includes each and every one of us, the believers and the disbelievers and everyone. Doesn't matter where the person is from, what color of skin, what nationality, we're all children of Adam, and Adam is from dust. That's why there is no superiority for one over the other. There is no superiority of an Arab over a non-Arab, or the opposite, except by the taqwa, by the fear of Allah, by being righteous. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, as a result of these facts that are mentioned before, He said, Ya Bani Adam. And that's a call that brings the honor and dignity for the sons of Adam to receive the order from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala honored the sons of Adam. For what reason? For them to be obedient to Allah. وَلَقَدْ كَبْضَمْنَا بَنِي آدَمْ. We had honored the sons of Adam. But if they choose to disown themselves and to dishonor themselves by disobeying Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, they become in the worst level ever. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned that in the Quran. So Ya Bani Adam, what is the call to the children of Adam? قَدْ أَنزَلْنَا عَلَيْكُمْ لِبَاسًا قَدْ أَنزَلْنَا عَلَيْكُمْ لِبَاسًا يُوَارِي سَوْآتِكُمْ وَرِيشًا. We had brought down to you, bestowed upon you, لِبَاسًا, which means clothing, يُوَارِي سَوْآتِكُمْ, covers your private parts, وَرِيشًا, and feather. This is all from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, reminding the human beings of the favor of Allah. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did not create the human beings to be walking naked in the streets as He created them. And some people, they think this is how the human beings used to be in the primitive era and so on. No, Adam alayhi salam was covered and was honored and dignified with being covered. The private parts was exposed as a result of the sin in Jannah. That when they went to the earth, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned here that He brought, bestowed upon them the clothing. Who's the one that taught Adam alayhi salam and the wife of Adam alayhi salam how to clothe themselves, how to cover themselves? And He subhanahu wa ta'ala, the one that provided that for them. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is mentioning that from the beginning of the creation of the human beings, not something that human beings, some people think that as a result of being civilized, they start covering themselves. Actually, we see nowadays that people start to uncover themselves, which is definitely a sign of being uncivilized. To be civilized, to be human, that means we cover ourselves, except for those who it's permissible to uncover oneself to, like a husband and a wife and so on. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is calling the sons of Adam to understand this thing and to show that this is a major thing. This is one of the ways of shaitan on the face of earth. It's not a simple matter, it's a major one. That's why you would find on the face of earth, it's always a subject that comes up, especially when the Muslims are holding fast to the deen of Allah, and they want to fulfill the orders of Allah with regards to the hijab and so on, you would find all kinds of enmity because of the works of shaitan. This is one of the things that he do on the face of earth, to uncover people, to make them live their life, to follow their desires and to go after their desires and so on. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, قَدْ أَنزَلْنَا عَلَيْكُمْ لِبَاسًا يُوَارِي سَوْآتِكُمْ وَرِيشًا, to cover your private parts and rishan and whether it's adornments or whatever different types of clothing that they would wear, but then directing the hearts of the believers and to the sons of Adam, that what's more important than all of this is libasu taqwa, the clothing of taqwa, the clothing of righteousness. The same way that a person would have clothes on to protect oneself from the heat or from the cold, to honor and dignifying oneself by covering and concealing the private parts and so on, the taqwa, the righteousness, to be obedient to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, also it's like a garment, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, وَلِبَاسُ التَّقْوَى. That means it's not just an action here or there, it's like a garment that a person is wearing. He's covered with a taqwa. That means the taqwa is from head to toe, in our eyes, in our seeing, in our hearing, in our speech, in our actions, in everything that we do, we observe righteousness. We are obedient to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, following the orders of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and that's what's better for the person than what a person wears. And as we know, that people adorn themselves with what they wear, and they take care of their clothing and what they wear in front of others and so on. What's more important is to take care of their taqwa and their fear of Allah, and how the taqwa of Allah is linked to clothing too. So if someone claim that the clothing has nothing to do with the fear of Allah, this is wrong. That opposes what the Quran is saying. For someone to say that a woman can disobey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and not to wear the hijab, and to think that she is having the garment of taqwa and righteousness, this is absolutely wrong. This is falsehood. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the one that ordered for the women to wear hijab. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the one that ordered the men also to wear in a modest way and so on. And the rulings of the awra and so on, it's something that is part of the deen of Allah. And to raise the children, to keep their pure nature, to cover themselves, to have honor and dignity in covering themselves, and to feel ashamed when a person is being uncovered and so on. We'll talk more inshallah ta'ala, and more one verse left before the end of this episode, after the break inshallah, so stay with us.
Muhammadur Rasulullah.
Often the companions of the Messenger of Allah, peace be upon him, asked him about the best act of worship, the best of deeds, the best of sayings, the best of people, or even the best of places. The purpose was to compete with each other in order to achieve the highest place in paradise through achieving the best of deeds. The idea of our program revolves around discussing and explaining only sound ahadith in which Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam has guided us to the best of acts of worship, or who will be the best of people. Stay tuned daily to watch our program, Best of the Best.
محمد رسول الله.
الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله. We are in verse number 26 from Surah Al-A'raf, talking about لباس التقوى, the garment of righteousness. That is best. The best thing is to have the garment of righteousness. And the word التقوى, for us to learn it, we need to read the Quran, to be obedient to Allah. The characteristics of the muttaqeen, the righteous ones, are mentioned throughout the entire Quran. Mentioned from the very beginning of Surah Al-Baqarah. The very first verses of Surah Al-Baqarah talks about the people of taqwa. And throughout the entire Quran, the characteristics of the righteous ones, not based on one's desire, not what people think or what people say. Everybody will claim that they're upon righteousness, and people will have their own definition of what righteousness is. But this is something that only Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the one that defines it in the revelation from Allah. So after showing the importance of covering oneself and having this modesty, that this is part of being righteous, and the garment of righteousness which is best, and for the person to be obedient to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, ذَلِكَ مِنْ آيَاتِ اللَّهِ لَعَلَّهُمْ يَذَّكَّرُونَ. This is from the ayat of Allah, from the signs of Allah, the fact that he ordered you to have specific ways of clothing to cover yourself and to observe these orders from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is from the signs of Allah. لَعَلَّهُمْ يَذَّكَّرُونَ, so that they would have a reminder. So that they would have a reminder to protect themselves from the hellfire, to be obedient to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to remember what happened to Adam alayhi salam, so that people do not willingly expose themselves. When Adam alayhi salam and his wife, they were exposed as a result of the sin. And it shows also that the sin exposes the person. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala concealed the faults of the believers, but when the person continued to commit sins, this can be a way for the person to be exposed. That's why the meaning of al-maghfirah is to conceal the faults and not to make the person exposed. Then after that, the last verse in this episode, inshallah, verse number 27, another call for the lessons to be learned from the story of Adam alayhi salam. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Ya Bani Adam, لا يفتننكم الشيطان كما أخرج أبويكم من الجنة ينزع عنهما لباسهما ليريهما سوآتهما إنه يراكم هو وقبيله من حيث لا ترونهم إنا جعلنا الشياطين أولياء للذين لا يؤمنون. Which means, O children of Adam, let not Shaytan, Satan, tempt you as he removed your parents from paradise, stripping them of their clothing to show them their private parts. Indeed, he sees you, he and his tribe, from where you do not see them. Indeed, we have made the devils allies to those who do not believe. This is a very important meanings here and great lessons to be learned from the story of Adam alayhi salam. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is calling the children of Adam again with such an important instructions for them. لا يفتننكم الشيطان. Do not let the shaytan يفتننكم, from the fitna. Do not let the shaytan tempt you. Do not let the shaytan make you fall into the fitna, to tempt you, to make you disobedient to Allah, to take you away from the orders of Allah. The same way that he did to your parents, كما أخرج أبويكم, to remember your parents. Who are your parents? Adam and his wife. He took them out of Jannah, كما أخرج أبويكم من الجنة, as he took your parents, your father and your mother, which is Adam and his wife, he took them out of Jannah. ينزع عنهما لباسهما. When he stripped them of their clothing, and again it's mentioned again to show the importance of this, and how that this is the goal of the shaitan. He did that to Adam alayhi salam and his wife. Adam alayhi salam, he did not, and his wife did not expose themselves, like some people they do today. But because of the sin, this led to this exposure. And because of that, shaitan, this is his goal, this is his way to get people to be stripped out of their clothing, to show their private parts, to show what needs to be covered, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ordered for the bodies to be covered, but they would expose it as a means of disobeying Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, out of his mercy, is calling the children of Adam, do not fall into the trap of shaitan. And one of the traps of shaitan, one of the major important issues of the ways and the traps of the shaitan, that he strips the clothing off of the people when they would do that willingly. When they think that this is part of being civilized, that when people are in the 21st century, that means they need to have less clothing, for example, which is, it does not make sense intellectually, it does not make sense when it comes to the revelation from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. There's nothing to oppose one's intellect and one's goodness and so on if a person is covered. Actually, it's the opposite. When a person is uncovered, then the intellect and the goodness of the human beings become focused on following their desires and having illegal relationships and the like of this. So, يَنْزِعُ عَنْهُمَا لِبَاسَهُمَا لِيُرِيَهُمَا سَوْآتِهِمَا. When he made them see their private parts of one another as it was covered, and because of the sin that what happened to them. And then another thing, so after this great important order from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the creator of all things, to the children of Adam, another one to show that something that gives not superiority for the shaitan, but makes many people deceived if they don't have the proper faith. With al-Iman, when people have the proper faith, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect them from the ways of the shaitan, because they know the tricks of the shaitan mentioned in the Qur'an and in the Sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ. When people do not follow the Qur'an and the Sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ, what happened? They do not know the ways of shaitan. And as a result of that, they would fall into the traps of shaitan. He says, إِنَّهُ يَرَاكُمْ هُوَ وَقَبِيلُهُ مِنْ حَيْثُ لَا تَرَوْنَهُمْ. That means, the shaitan, he sees you هو وقبيله, him and his people, his tribe, من حيث لا ترونهم, from where you do not see them. We do not see the shayateen. When the shaitan, imagine the shaitan whispers to a person, you know, sometimes they make this in like cartoons for the children, you know, regardless whether this is permissible or not, it's not like this where the shaitan having this ugly face and he is talking to the human being. If he's exposed and he's shown with his identity as the shaitan, people would run away from listening to the ways of the shaitan. But that's not the case on the face of earth. The shaitan, he runs in the bloodstream. He whispers to the people and people think that this is themselves. And this is a great thing because it comes from themselves. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying that he sees you while you do not see him. So that makes it easy for him to whisper. And he would, being hidden, that means you do not see your enemy, he sees you. But how do the believers, or how do the people see then the shaitan? How to protect themselves when they do not know their, when they do not see their enemy, right? The enemy is not going to come and hit you physically, like you have to see him to protect yourself. The enmity of shaitan is only in whispering. So the whispering, adorning the evil, whispering to the human being, how to protect yourself from it? Get to know what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants from us in the Quran and in the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And then when the whispers are against this, then this is the ways of the shaitan. A person should stay away from it. And to be aware that he's constantly whispering. So not to rely on oneself, not to rely on one's knowledge and one's opinion, but rather a person should ask the people of knowledge. A person should be upon certainty when it comes to matters of knowledge, so that he or she are not deceived by the shaitan. إِنَّهُ يَرَاكُمْ هُوَ وَقَبِيلُهُ, him and his tribe, they see you from where you do not see them. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, إِنَّا جَعَلْنَا الشَّيَاطِينَ أَوْلِيَاءَ لِلَّذِينَ لَا يُؤْمِنُونَ, we made the shayateen as awliya, allies to those who do not believe. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made them their allies. And allying oneself with someone else, that means with victory, with support, with help, with bringing all kinds of ideas and doubts and things of that nature. And people think that this is intellectual when it's all the works of the shayateen, the works of the devils. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us from that. So the matter is made very clear. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the most merciful. He exposed the ways of the shaitan so that nobody would say, I did not know. Or for people to seek excuses because they don't see the shaitan. You already been informed that you do not see him and he sees you. And you've already been informed that he would whisper to you to do evil. And how to protect yourself, part of it is knowledge, to know what is evil and what is right according to what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed. And to seek help from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala by being steadfast upon this. As you see in these few verses, there are great benefits. First of all, the shaitan, when someone obeys him in the disobedience of Allah, a person falls. That means we elevate ourselves with the good deeds, the iman increases and decreases. The decrease of al-iman, that means a person followed the ways of the shaitan, the devil. The shaitan, when he's being followed, he becomes stronger on the person. And when a person disobeys the shaitan becomes weaker and weaker. That's why it's a constant battle, yes, and a person should not be forgetful. We have to always be focused that we are being watched. We are being followed by the shaitan, to make us slip, to make us deviate from the straight path, and to make sure that whatever decisions, whatever directions, whatever move we make, whatever speech we say, it has to be according to what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants from us, as is mentioned in the Book of Allah and the Sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ, and to be warned against the ways of the shayateen. Also, we learned that it's nothing but deception. It's not reality. It's all deception. And people have to be aware of this, and the reality of things, and the way things are, without any deception, is what's mentioned in the Quran and in the Sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ. So again, when we are being always asked to learn the deen of Allah, or to ask the people of knowledge, but to live our life like this, thinking that we are righteous, when we might be deceived by the shaitan, then this is a very dangerous one. We have to either have the knowledge, or to ask the people of knowledge to be upon the light of knowledge and not to be deceived. Also, it shows that how sins exposes the person. And this is a benefit that some of the ulama they mentioned. When someone do not observe modesty and shyness in the proper clothing, that means there are other sins that expose the person. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the most merciful and He is the most just. when someone chooses to expose what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ordered to be covered, that means there are other sins that maybe we do not see that is being committed, and as a result of that, a person is exposed. It's like a punishment. When a person is not observing the rulings of covering the awrah, that person is being punished on the face of earth till he repents to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the door and the gate of repentance is open as long as the person is alive. So this is a form of punishment. Punishment of another sin. The sin brings other sins and more sins as a benefit to be extracted from this. So therefore, we should fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and a sincere advice for those who do not observe the hijab, for those men, those who would expose also their private parts and so on, whether it's in front of men or in front of women or whatever there is, to protect themselves. And we say private parts is not what as defined by certain nationalities and so on, it's according to the deen of Islam. The awra for the men is from the navel to the knees, and for the woman, the entire body of the woman is awra, as with the differences of opinions among the people of knowledge. But the point here is to observe the hijab and to lower the gaze. And this is part of our religion. Otherwise, if a person leaves himself to the sin, then that leads him to be punished on the face of earth by being exposed, as what happened to Adam alayhi salam. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He does not punish unless the matter became clear. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made it clear to Adam alayhi salam and his wife. He made it clear to them that the shaitan is their enemy, and he's a clear enemy, even though he's hidden, but he's very clear. Why? Because he is exposed by the revelation from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We also learn how to repent. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala teaches us how the prophets of Allah, they repent, so that we follow the same path when we repent to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Acknowledging the sin, acknowledging that we did wrongdoing to themselves, is halfway to repent. And then a person asks Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for forgiveness, quitting the sin, regretting the sin, having the strong will that a person would not commit it again, and to seek the forgiveness and the mercy from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and to see that if a person is not forgiven, he is a loser. He's a loser in this life and in the hereafter, to redefine things according to what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants from us. Also, one of the great benefits is that the place of settling of the human beings on the face of earth, this is going to be the case till the day of judgment. Human beings are not going to escape to live in another planet. Right? The human beings will continue to live on the face of earth till a specific time, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned. And the enmity of shaitan will continue to be. And some people win and some people they lose. Facts, advices, lessons, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned it in these verses. Covering oneself, the garment of righteousness, to be among the people of taqwa, to be always reminded of the good things because we tend to forget, not to be deceived like the way that Adam alayhi salam was deceived and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accepted his repentance, and the superiority of the shaitan, which he sees us and we don't see him, but we have the clear revelation from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And those who turned away from the revelation of Allah, they are always deceived and defeated by the shaitan. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us benefit from what we heard, and to make these verses as blessings for us and guidance and light for us to be steadfast on the Salat al-Mustaqim, on the straight path. Until next time, I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to protect you all. Wa sallallahu wa sallam wa baraka ala Muhammadin wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Illa alladhina tabu wa aslahu wa bayyanu fa'ulaika atubu alayhim. وأنا التواب الرحيم
فادعوا الله مخلصين له الدين ولو كره الكافرون
يا زكريا إنا نبشرك بغلام
يا أيها النبي إنا شاهداً